I was in the U.S. Air Force, and I was a sergeant, and I was stationed at Tansanut Air Force Base in Saigon. And one of our primary goals, objectives, whatever you want to call it, was to transport ordnance from Saigon Harbor to Benoit, which was 17 miles north. And then the fighter planes dropped that stuff up north. But that was a 365, 7 days a week, because there was always a ship in the harbor. And Sunday was just like any other day when you're in war. It's just another day. I was also a dispatcher, but I also drove. And when you went to the port, they had to load. And you've probably seen some of that on TV, where they loaded the bombs and then they were tied down onto our 18-wheelers. And we usually had a convoy, 5 to 10, depending on what was going on. And we were able to get really good after 6 months. Instead of just making one trip a night, we could make two. From 4:30, our shift was from 4:30 to 7:30 in the morning. So we got so good, our drivers and the crew at the docks got so good that we could do two trips a night rather than just one. And we thought that was pretty good, because we were just doing our job. So, and then I was a dispatcher, and our other primary goal was to pick up all the flight crews in the morning and get them down to base operations. And then they flew the C-130s and the C-123s. We had a few fighters there, but just for a little protection, but basically cargo planes. And they flew in and out of the Philippines, Clark Air Force Base, bringing supplies back to Tansanut. When you go to war, when you come home, you are never the same person. The night of the Tet Offensive, it's the Vietnamese New Year on January the 30th and 31st. And so we're outside, it's 02:30 in the morning, and we're watching all the fireworks. I mean, you think we shoot fireworks, you should see the fireworks they shoot. And then here comes Puff the Magic Dragon, which is an old C-47, which has got two M-60s out of the back, and they're just a whirring. And it just seemed, I said, something's not right, because Puff is not usually doing all that, and all of a sudden the sirens went off. And then the rockets started to come. And then we knew why Puff was, what the whirring was all about. I was the chief dispatcher that night, and I said, everybody grab, I just got off the phone with Sergeant Bloom at Central Security Control, and then the phone went dead. I said, get your M16s and get down to the bunker. So I was in the dispatch office, and I was getting ready to go down to the bunker, and the rockets were coming in, and where the motor pool was, on the other side of the street, was the heliport. And of course, they missed their mark and they started hitting our motor pool. And what they wanted was the choppers. We got every one of them off the ground that was operational before they finally got their clicks right. But a rocket hit from here to that curtain over there and blew the windows out and blew me across the room. The roof caved in. And I was wondering if I was still alive, but I was. And so I knew I had a .45, and I still had that. So I crawled over to the cabinet, and I got an M16 out and a bunch of magazines. And I said, well, it's pitch black. All power was gone. And so I said, well, we'll just crawl under this desk here, and we'll wait. Well, now we're at 0300, and I know that first light's not till 0500. And so anyway, then I hear voices, and here Charlie had breached our perimeter. They weren't our voices, they were Charlie's voices, Vietnamese. And I thought, you know, I could get those guys. And then the Lord said to me, you stay right where you're at because you'll be the only flash that they see, and they'll destroy that building that you're in. So anyway, then you're laying there and you're breathing and there isn't anything else. And you think, my God, they're gonna hear me breathing. And never heard any more voices. And then we're getting close to 0500. And all at once I hear voices, and there are voices. And so I hollered out, Sergeant Mayor, 377 Transportation, I'm alone in here. And it was a captain, he said. I found that out when I got it. He says, come on out with your hands up. So I came out and I said, sir, I sure am glad to see you. It was the Screaming Eagles, the 101st Airborne. And I could hear the firefights going on during the night. And they said, that was us. We were trying to save your heliport, and we did. So anyway, it was quite an experience. And I said, we got a bunch of people down the bunker. Send some guys down there and see if they're all still alive. And so anyway, they come up and they say, well, Hawk, we thought you were dead. I said, well, I was wondering. But I said, all right, let's take all the tractors, everything that's ready. And I said, hook up all the flatbeds. I said, make sure we got full fuel. I said, what are we doing? I said, never mind, just get her done. And then our colonel finally got there about 9:30 hours. And I said, sir, all the rigs are ready to go. And he said to me, how did you know that I was going to do that? I said, sir, I don't know, but I know what the mission's going to be today. We're going to be driving the streets of the base because it's a huge compound, and we lost a lot of guys. And all the bodies were put on the flatbeds and taken to the morgue. Now, the drivers didn't do anything. They just drove. But that was going to be the deal, because that's what happens in war. Somebody has to go and get the corpses picked up and then get them over to the morgue. And so anyway, we made it through that. And, of course, the Tet Offensive lasted for like 50 days. Way was the capital was a real battle, and they literally tore that magnificent city apart, us and them. But anyway, we finally prevailed in that setting at that time. I went home in October like I was supposed to, and but you're never the same when you come back. And you don't, what I told you, I didn't tell my wife or anybody for 40 years. I was in education. I went to college. I got my educational degree, and I taught and coached for 14 years. And then I was a superintendent of schools for 15. And then I retired. And so during that period, and we had 5 children, but during that period, When you're a teacher and a coach, there's always something going on. So the mind is always spinning. And see, way back in that hole is the war. See, it's way back there. Okay, and then I became superintendent of schools. And then you got to speak to this committee and that committee. And you got to go out in the community and speak to the veterans and speak to the ladies' quilting club, whoever wants you. Okay, so there's always something that's making the mind spin. Okay. So I retired, and after 60 days, I told my wife, this is never going to work, because the war came back. See, there was nothing to take up that space. Every day, talking to the kids, making sure this was done, well, that was done, talking to this teacher. And so I came over to the VA, and I was able to get into the VA, and then I got sick. And from Agent Orange. So I have a pacemaker defibrillator that keeps me alive. And I thank God every morning for modern technocracy, whoever invented it. And they put it in out at North Central Heart, Dr. Hibbard and Dr. Olson, who have studied Agent Orange. And so they see a number of our veterans who have pacemaker defibrillators because their heart has been attacked by Agent Orange. And I've had cancer and I'm beating that. I have diabetes, I have PTSD, but we have 5 children, we have 8 grandchildren, and I'm alive. And I have the best wife in the world. She's stuck with me all through all this stuff. And finally, let's see, about four years ago, when everybody was at our house for Christmas, I'd been working with Dr. Lithgow at the VA. And he brought me back. He's a great doctor. You know, what do you smell? He'd have me close my eyes and we'd just sit there. What do you smell? What do you hear? What are you doing on this date? And so I recorded, and I still have it, he said, this is what we do. We record every time you're here. And then you play that back to you and you write down if you missed something. And man, there was always something that was supposed to go in there. And so then when I was all done, he said, now you need to tell your wife, and then you need to tell your children and any grandchildren who the parents think are old enough. And I've done that. Felt good. I was raised Lutheran, and so I was always aware of the Almighty. But when you get orders that you're going to war, well, you know, you do a little bit more. And since I came back, we've been in Bible study for a long time, and you learn a lot of things. And people always say at work, boy, you know a lot about the Bible. I said, no, I'm just getting started. But they always say, well, what's going to happen next? I said, pick up the book of Revelations and start reading. And when you're through, read it again. And then again and again and again and again. At some point in time, you'll start to figure out what's going on, because that book will tell you everything that has gone on in this world and everything that's going to come until the end. See? So anyway, it's... yeah, God has been good to us. My wife's a 2-time cancer survivor. So he's been very good to us. South Dakotans are no-nonsense people. We grew up, and when your dad told you to do something, you did it. Okay? Dad went to war between... I have 5 brothers. One of them passed of a heart attack. I was 4 in the Air Force. I have another brother that was 4 in the Air Force. My brother Lonnie was a sergeant major with 21, and brother Rick was a retired colonel now from the Air Force with 22. So our family has done what we thought we were supposed to do. Our daughter Amberlynn was in the South Dakota National Guard, and then they moved to Alaska. Well, they couldn't send both her husband and her to the war together, so they sent her husband to Fort Wainwright in Alaska, because they took all the regular Army guys out and sent them to Afghanistan, and our daughter Amber went to Afghanistan. So we have another child who was in the war. So anyway, as Merle Haggard would say back in the day, we don't burn our graft cards down on Main Street. We didn't do that in South Dakota, because if you would have tried that, you wouldn't have survived very. You had a good beating. Oh, yeah, yeah. We don't put up with that stuff, and we still don't put up with that stuff. I think you know that. All you got to do is look around, you know. Has it changed South Dakota? We have a large monument in Pierre on the lake. It's called the Vietnam memorial for our South Dakotans. Okay, we have 192 on the wall. You heard the gentleman talk about there's 192 South Dakotans out there. Now, what we also have there, we also have Iraq, Afghanistan, all the guys and gals that have given their life there. So we don't quit. I work at the Veterans Administration, and the Iraq and Afghanistan people say, thank you, Vietnam vets, for what you did for us, because we're the ones that paid the price, and they spit on us and called us everything in the book, but we kept fighting. This is our 53rd year that we're still fighting for our Vietnam veteran benefits. In the meantime, we got Congress to pass the bill that allows them 5 years of coverage in the VA healthcare system for anything that they got. If they got a nut chew, a cold, they can go there and we don't charge them. They'll give them medicine and get them fixed up. And that's great. When we came back, they ran us through just like a herd of cattle going onto a train. Get these people out of here. You know, now when they come back, they get the briefing, they get forms to fill out if they think that there's a disability or something. So they're all, I mean, and we worked hard to get that accomplished, and we're glad that we did that. And so are they. South Dakota, you know, we have a bunch of Gold Star mothers here, and there are still some that are alive. Mrs. Calise from Howard, her son, Tommy, was shot down in 1967, and we've still not recovered his remains. So we do not know whether he was able to bail out or whether he went down with the plane, but we've been to the crash site a number of times and haven't been able to find anything. And what really makes it more difficult is that, see, the life expectancy of the Vietnamese in that day was like 30. Okay, most people are all dead, and unless their kids passed it on to their kids, okay, yeah, that guy bailed out and we got him over here. See, we may never find Tommy Calise, and that's all Mom wants, is her boy back. The world. Well, look at the wars we got. If you didn't know, we have troops in 44 different countries today. 44. We got the best Navy SEALs on the planet, that's for sure.